The Early Christian Writings of Justin Martyr. By Justin the Philosopher. Podcast 1 of 22. Copyright 2019 by Alan Lewis Silva. All rights reserved. ISBN 9-781-794-87842-6. Part 1. The Discourse to the Greeks. Chapter 1. Justin justifies his departure from Greek customs. Do not suppose, ye Greeks, that my separation from your customs is unreasonable and unthinking, for I found in them nothing that is holy or acceptable to God. For the very compositions of your poets are monuments of madness and intemperance. For anyone who becomes the scholar of your most eminent instructor, is more beset by difficulties than all men besides. For first they say that Agamemnon, abetting the extravagant lust of his brother, and his madness and unrestrained desire, readily gave even his daughter to be sacrificed, and troubled all Greece that he might rescue Helen, who had been ravished by the leprous shepherd. But when in the course of the war they took captives, Agamemnon was himself taken captive by Chryses, and for Briseis' sake kindled a feud with the son of Thetis. And Pelides himself, who crossed the river, overthrew Troy and subdued Hector, this your hero became the slave of Polyxena, and was conquered by a dead Amazon, and putting off the god-fabricated armor, and donning the hymeneal robe, he became a sacrifice of love in the temple of Apollo. And the Ithacan Odysseus made a virtue of a vice. And indeed his sailing past the Sirens gave evidence that he was destitute of worthy prudence, because he could not depend on his prudence for stopping his ears. Ajax, son of Telamon, who bore the shield of sevenfold ox hide, went mad when he was defeated in the contest with Odysseus for the Amour. Such things I have no desire to be instructed in. Of such virtue I am not covetous, that I should believe the myths of Homer. For the whole rhapsody, the beginning and end both of the Iliad and the Odyssey is a woman. Chapter 2. The Greek Theogony Exposed. But since, next to Homer, Hesiod wrote his works and days, who will believe his driveling theogony? For they say that Cronos, the son of Ouranos, in the beginning slew his father, and possessed himself of his rule, and that, being seized with a panic lest he should himself suffer in the same way, he preferred devouring his children, but that, by the craft of the curettes, Jupiter was conveyed away and kept in secret, and afterwards bound his father with chains, and divided the empire, Jupiter receiving, as the story goes, the air, and Neptune the deep, and Pluto the portion of Hades. But Pluto ravished Proserpine, and Ceres sought her child wandering through the deserts. And this myth was celebrated in the Eleusinian fire. Again, Neptune ravished Melanippe when she was drawing water, besides abusing a host of Nereids, not a few, whose names, were we to recount them, would cost us a multitude of words. And as for Jupiter, he was a various adulterer, with Antiope as a satyr, with Danaea as gold, and with Europa as a bull, with Leda, moreover, he assumed wings. For the love of Semele proved both his unchastity and the jealousy of Semele. And they say that he carried off the Phrygian Ganymede to be his cupbearer. These, then, are the exploits of the sons of Saturn. And your illustrious son of Latona, who professed soothsaying, convicted himself of lying. He pursued Daphne, but did not gain possession of her, and to Hyacinthus, who loved him, he did not foretell his death. And I say nothing of the masculine character of Minerva, nor of the feminine nature of Bacchus, nor of the fornicating disposition of Venus. Read to Jupiter, ye Greeks, the law against parricides, and the penalty of adultery, and the ignominy of paederasty. Teach Minerva and Diana the works of women, and Bacchus the works of men. What seemliness is there in a woman's girding herself with armor, or in a man's decorating himself with cymbals, and garlands, and female attire, and accompanied by a herd of Bacchanalian women? Chapter 3. Follies of the Greek Mythology. For Hercules, celebrated by his three knights, sung by the poets for his successful labors, the son of Jupiter, who slew the lion and destroyed the many-headed Hydra, who put to death the fierce and mighty boar, and was able to kill the fleet man-eating birds, and brought up from Hades the three-headed dog, who effectually cleansed the huge Aegean building from its dung, and killed the bulls and the stag whose nostrils breathed fire, and plucked the golden fruit from the tree, and slew the poisonous serpent, and for some reason, which it is not lawful to utter, killed Aeclaus, and the guest slaying Busiris, and crossed the mountains that he might get water which gave forth an articulate speech, as the story goes, he who was able to do so many and such like and so great deeds as these, how childishly he was delighted to be stunned by the symbols of the satyrs, and to be conquered by the love of woman, and to be struck on the hips by the laughing Lydda. And at last, not being able to put off the tunic of Nesha's, himself kindling his own funeral pile, so he died. Let Vulcan lay aside his envy, and not be jealous if he is hated because he is old and club-footed, and Mars loved, because young and beautiful. Since, therefore, ye Greeks, your gods are convicted of intemperance, and your heroes are effeminate, as the histories on which your dramas are founded have declared, such as the curse of Atreus, the bed of Thyestes and the taint in the house of Pelops, and Danaus murdering through hatred and making Aegyptus childless in the intoxication of his rage, and the Thyestean banquet spread by the Furies. And Procne is to this day flitting about, lamenting, and her sister of Athens shrills with her tongue cut out. For what need is there of speaking of the goat of Oedipus, and the murder of Leos, and the marrying his mother, and the mutual slaughter of those who were at once his brothers and his sons? Chapter 4 Shameless Practices of the Greeks. And your public assemblies I have come to hate. For there are excessive banquetings, and subtle flutes which provoke to lustful movements, and useless and luxurious anointings, and crowning with garlands. With such a mass of evils do you banish shame, and ye fill your minds with them, and are carried away by intemperance, and indulge as a common practice in wicked and insane fornication. And this further I would say to you, why are you, being a Greek, indignant at your son when he imitates Jupiter, and rises against you and defrauds you of your own wife? Why do you count him your enemy, and yet worship one that is like him? And why do you blame your wife for living in Unchastity, and yet honor Venus with shrines? If indeed these things had been related by others, they would have seemed to be mere slanderous accusations, and not truth. But now your own poets sing these things, and your histories noisily publish them. Chapter 5 Closing Appeal. Henceforth, ye Greeks, come and partake of incomparable wisdom, and be instructed by the divine word, and acquaint yourselves with the King Immortal, and do not recognize those men as heroes who slaughter whole nations. For our own ruler, the divine word, who even now constantly aids us, does not desire strength of body and beauty of feature, nor yet the high spirit of earth's nobility, but a pure soul, fortified by holiness, and the watchwords of our King, holy actions, for through the word power passes into the soul. O trumpet of peace to the soul that is at war! O weapon that puttest to flight terrible passions! O instruction that quenches the innate fire of the soul! The word exercises an influence which does not make poets, it does not equip philosophers nor skilled orators, but by its instruction it makes mortals immortal, mortals gods, and from the earth transports them to the realms above Olympus. Come, be taught, become as I am, for I, too, was as ye are. These have conquered me the divinity of the instruction, and the power of the word, for as a skilled serpent charmer lures the terrible reptile from his den and causes it to flee, so the word drives the fearful passions of our sensual nature from the very recesses of the soul, first driving forth lust, through which every ill is begotten hatreds, strife, envy, emulations, anger, and such like. Lust being once banished, the soul becomes calm and serene. And being set free from the ills in which it was sunk up to the neck, it returns to him who made it. For it is fit that it be restored to that state whence it departed, whence every soul was or is.